Welcome, everybody. How are we doing today? Well, we are going to talk about a lot of stuff today. Are you guys ready? Are you ready to kind of be awake and lively? I know we're all a little sleep deprived today, but we have a lot of stuff to cover today. We have been in a series called Against the Current for a few weeks now, and Jim has been kind of just pounding away along with what Paul was sharing. The first two chapters are really just a lot of theology, and a lot of times they call it Christology. It is that time where they basically just take, and Paul is just pounding down the fact, this is who Jesus Christ is. This is what he's done. This is what he's going to do. And this is for you. And he basically just pounds two chapters, and that's what we've been, you know, listening to Jim for the last 2 weeks, is pound it. Who is Christ? What is he here for? What did he come for? And what's he going to do? And how is he supposed to play a role in your life? Now we're going to kind of turn the corner just a little bit, and we're going to get a little bit more into a life application. Now, life application, a lot of times we're theology type people. You guys are a lot of brainiacs, and that's why I get intimidated speaking up here, because you guys are way smarter than I am. And you're very knowledgeable. And there's a lot of people in this world that are really, really smart, but they can't drive a car. Or they can't do simple tasks. And you just think, where's all this brain? You're so smart, but there's so many simple tasks you can't pull off. And so sometimes we all run into this thing where we get really smart, but the application of what we know here doesn't ever come out here into the real world. And so today we're turning the corner into application. Normally when we get into application, this becomes a little bit more personal. And so some of you are going to squirm in your seats a little bit today. Is that okay? We all in agreement? We're just going to basically just go through Colossians 3, and we're just going to kind of learn about some application. And Paul has a few very distinct ways that he kind of lays things out for us. The first thing he's trying to do in Colossians, he's trying to set up the church in the Colossians were actually a very good church. They're pretty wise. They were doing really well. They were a young church. They're doing really well. They're not like Corinth, which had a lot of weird, creepy stuff going on in that church, okay? You know, they had some weird things happen in the church of Corinth. The Colossians were pretty solid. They were doing really well. But Paul still writes this letter, and he goes, here's who Christ is. I want to emphasize, here's who Christ is. Here's who Christ is. And now I'm going to throw out a warning to you. Let me ask this question. How many of you guys have been to Holiday World? Raise your hands. Holiday World people. Okay, most. This is good. This is good. How many people love going to Holiday World? Raise your hands. Yes, we love going. There's a few things with Holiday World, though, that are a little kind of crazy. Whenever you go to any kind of water park, how many people like the really, like, psycho, downhill, steep things, and you have to climb up the big, steep towers to get there? You got all of those? You know, I love those, but there's a couple things I don't like about those, is the steep stairs. You know, it's not the steep stairs, really, that get me. You know what it is? It's when you're on steep stairs, you have butts in your face. And not all butts are made the same, you know? And so you're standing on these steep stairs, and you got a bottom about right here. And you're half the time, you're sitting there going, if I would have just got him a little bit earlier, I'd have a better view here. Okay, so I'm just saying. And the people behind me are going, man, I should have got here earlier, you know? That's just the reality of right on the stairs. They're just really steep. And I find myself, you know, I'm a little ADD, and my mind just wanders. And I apologize ahead of time for just things that might come out of my mouth today. Sometimes I lose my filter. Here's the other thing, as I'm standing there for 45 minutes waiting for a 30-second ride. Here's what I'm doing, my mind's wandering, it's going, the tattoos that people choose to get, and I know all of your guys' tattoos are awesome, they're perfect, they're wonderful. But there's some tattoos out there that just, you know, are not funny, and you're just kind of like, what does that mean? What were you thinking? What were you drinking when you got that tattoo? And then the unhealthy side of me starts coming out because you're basically raised in their bathing suits. You're going, where does that vine end up? I'll let your mind settle down. The little tattoo vines, they go all different places and they vanish and they come back. You're like, what is the deal with that? And it makes your mind start thinking weird, creepy things. Okay, guys, I'm sorry, I'm exposing us a little bit today. This is what goes on in our minds as we stand in any place where there's bathing suits and water parks, okay? This is what happens. So these things are kind of crazy. You got butts in your face. You got weird tattoos. You got hair. Hair that shouldn't be where it's at. You know, I often think at that place they should have those instead of like, you get free sunscreen, free Mountain Dews. They should have free Nair. Remember that stuff? You know, everybody just loads up. If you don't know what that is, it's the stuff you put on and eats your hair off, and the first two layers of skin too. So, matter of fact, after our first time of going to Holiday World, we got home, and me and I love my daughter. She's awesome. And we made this deal that she'll pull my back hairs off my back. So she thinks it's fun. The dad gives a tweezer. She loves stabbing me. She loves hearing me, ow, ow. She'll pull the back hairs off. So you got when she turns 18, if I can get her to do it till she's 18, after that, you guys are in trouble. You're in trouble. I'm going back to Holiday World and going, look what I got, you know. And so that's Holiday World, okay? So we think, well, why are we talking about this? Well, in Holiday World, there's a couple different parts of the park. You got your big, crazy water slides that you wait in line. You got steep stairs. Then as you get a little older, you start thinking, where should I really be? And then you look off as you're up on those steep stairs, and you look over just over yonder, and you think, there's the Lazy River. What a great place to be is the Lazy River. You know, because after a little while, when you look at all these crazy things, when you get older, you just start thinking, how many Tylenol did I pack this week? You know, because the next day you're going to be sore. So we all, as we get a little bit older, we mosey over to the Lazy River. And Paul is kind of sharing, he goes, yes, there are things, and we're going to talk about a list of things that are big and crazy, and you can see from a mile away that is high risk. But Paul's mostly talking about the Lazy River in this passage, in this book that we're talking about today. Because most of us, when we get to the Lazy River, when you first walk in, as soon as you walk just beyond the entry and you got that tube in hand, the current starts picking up. It's kind of pushing. Whether you got a tube or not, it wants to push you that way. And that's where we spend a lot of our time. You get in there, and we can stand there for a little while, but it becomes a little annoying and just not very fun to just be continually fighting the current, trying to stay in one place. So what do? Jump on our big yellow tube, kick back, and let the currents take us around and around and around and around. My father-in-law can spend the entire day with his little hat over his face and just go around that thing for hours, all day long. That's all he'll want to do. Now you go, why do we care about that? Because what we're going to talk about in this passage, in this application we're talking about, is really what Paul's warning us about, is that many of us have become accustomed to the Lazy River. We got into the currents when we were young, and we would fight the currents, and we were like ready to go. And then at some point, we got worn out from fighting the currents, and we just said, give me a tube. We kicked back in our tube, and we went with the current of the world, and it just keeps taking us around and around and around. When you ask Christ into your life, for those who call yourselves believers, there is no neutral. There is no standing still. There is no drifting with the currents. We are called to be against the currents. And so as we start getting this passage, I'm not teaching you anything you guys don't know, but I'm just going to ask a big upfront question. Did you start drifting? Did you get lazy in the river and just start cruising along with the world's ways? I mean, we see this happen all the time, and there's things that 5-10 years ago you thought, I'll never do that, and you're doing it. You think 10 years ago you said, I will never find myself in that situation, and you're like, I'm in it. And it's because you kicked back and you enjoyed the current. We usually gravitate to things that are pleasurable. That's the reality. So we're going to talk in this passage. So we're going to kind of have this lazy river mentality in our mind. And Paul's trying to warn us, don't get lazy. Don't get caught in the current. You have to push things through. And so the very first thing, he's going to refresh us again in chapter 3. Read this here with me. It says, since then you have been raised with Christ. Set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. First thing he's doing, he's going, bam, I want you to know, you are different. Something has changed. Because of the first two chapters I described, here's what Christ did. This is now that, because of this, this is different. You're different. You've been raised. Your heart's been set apart. It's been with Christ. How you used to live has to be different than how you live now. And so he just starts right up front. Because of this, here's the change. Here's the change that needs to take place. Read this passage, because it goes this. It says, set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. Because let's be honest, usually we find ourselves looking at earthly stuff. We look at earthly problems. We look at earthly issues. But he's saying, set your minds on things above. Now, to get this kind of mentality of set your minds on something, I kind of see it as being you've got to be focused. You could be relentless. And I'll tell you one time, okay, this is, so when I first met my wife the very first time, she was one of my youth volunteers, and she was dating another young man. My wife's a bit younger than me. She's like 12 years younger, and so I kind of already felt like there was no chance of ever getting even to talk to her or date her, but she was one of my youth volunteers, and I knew that her and this guy were kind of in this little bit of a rocky relationship. And I thought, I got good shoulders to cry on, you know? These are good shoulders to cry on. And so I would hang out, and I would wait, and I would see them out there talking, and I would just kind of watch, and I'd kind of peer out my office window because they'd be out in the parking lot talking, and I'd be peering out my window. I know we call this stalking now. I know. I know it sounds like stalking, but it wasn't stalking. It's relentless pursuit, okay? This relentless pursuit. I would gaze out the window, and I'd watch, and I'd wait for how the thing, you know, did they get in the car together and drive off, or was it someone standing there crying? Was it, I would just kind of watch, and I'd wait, and I would kind of church. I'd make sure I was sitting really close to where she was at so I could, like, bump into her and start talking to her. I mean, you've all done it, right? Am I wrong? We've all been stalkers at some point, haven't we? We've all stalked someone. Some of you have gone to jail for it, but most of us, we have no limits. And so we basically have this time, and I was relentlessly pursuing her. It was against the odds. I was 12 years older. She was 20. I was 32. That creeps me out even today. And when my daughter comes when she's 20, she is not dating a 32-year-old. I don't care what she says. I'm going to have a long day going that when that happens. So it's a relentless pursuit. And you can think of something that you relentlessly pursued that you thought, I'm going to scheme. I'm going to set my mind on accomplishing this task, meeting this person, to being around them as much as I can, to be in the vicinity of them as much as I can, to watch what they're doing, to see how I can be a part of their life. And that's what we're called to do with God. We're kind of called to stalk God, to be there close to him, to know where he's at. We're setting our minds on him. Our minds are focused on, we're like, I want to be close so that I can see what he's doing. Because I want to be like him. I want to be in a better relationship with him. I want to get to know him better. And so we do that a lot. We find that we're kind of setting ourselves. We pursue Jesus. And so when we see this, we set our minds on these things. And so when we set our minds on things, then we start building a better relationship. We have better chances of capturing what God wants us to be like, what God wants in our relationships with him. So that's the first thing. So we got to kind of think, fine, how do I set my minds on these things? The next thing is this godly perspective. And I know a lot of us, it's just not on earthly things. It's hard to focus in a godly perspective way. Most of us, we have a lot of stuff going on. And a good way to find out where you stand is when you wake up in the morning, what's the first thing you think about? Does it God anywhere in the first 10 minutes? Is God in the first hour? Is God in the first daylight? And this is the thing. It's this call to be like, when I start thinking through my day, when I start thinking through the things from yesterday, what is the filter I start putting things through? And God is calling us to put it not on earthly things, but to set our minds on him and things above. When I wake up and I think about the day and who I got to face, you know, I got clients that I really don't like. They drive me crazy, and I got to think, how can God help me through that time? How can God help me deal better with this client? God, give me patience. God, give me compassion. We're going to talk about that a little bit later. But it's his mentality. I got to seek at that time, filtering everything that is about to happen to me that day through the filter of eternity. Is the thing I'm stressing out about really that big of a stressor? Is the thing I'm stressing, and I'm be honest, sometimes it is. Sometimes they're huge. And so then your perspective might have to change a little bit even more. It might be, before I leave this house, I need God's presence. I need God's power today. And so before I even leave this bedroom, leave this bed, leave this house, leave this car, I got to seek out his perspective on what's happening in my life. And that's how we change our minds. We set our minds so that we relentlessly pursue to be near. And then when we find these things, when things start happening in life, we basically are more adapt to know the filter of God and how God sees things. So that's just, we're not even now the first or second verses now. You see how much is going on in this passage? You see with this passage, this life application is going to be so tough as we talk through today. So let's move on a little bit further. Verse 3 says this, "For you died and your life is now hidden with Christ in God." Verse 4, "When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also appear with him in glory." That's a lot of stuff. Think of this. For you died in Christ, and your life is now hidden in him. I want to kind of just show you some things here. See if I can get rid of some of these. My daughter, a few years ago, she was at school, and we were due for our parent-teacher conference, and the teacher asked us this question. I mean, you normally go in, hey, how are you doing today, you know, and all of a sudden you do the small talk. And then the teacher's pretty much right on point, goes to ask this question. She goes, so, Mr. Webb, what do you do for a living? She goes, and before I even had a chance to answer, she kind of goes, and you can tell there's a little bit of skepticism. She thinks she maybe, she goes, Samantha so far has told us that you're a realtor, you're a police officer, and you're a pastor. Now, I'm sure the teacher had great intentions, but I think somewhere in her mind, she thinks, we got an imaginative little girl here who daddy is everything in the world, okay? And she's going to catch us in this. But what she, and I said, well, I'm all three of those. And she goes, oh. And you can tell it's kind of like one of those ones, like, I didn't think that was going to be the answer. You know, I thought we were going to catch Samantha in this little bit of a lie. Now, the reason I bring this up is because it is true, in a matter of one weekend, I will play three different roles in life, and I will wear three different wardrobes in life. So I might, on Friday night, I go and I put on, some of you might not know, I'm a reserve sheriff deputy for Johnson County, and I put on a bulletproof vest, which I really like because it smooths out my belly. It's hard not to look real. You can look pretty tough, and then you got, you know, 4 inches, you know, smoothing things off. So, and I put this on, and even during times of that, I put on a different wardrobe, and I'll put on my nice cooling thing. I'll put on this big belt, where it's like 20-some pounds, and, you know, it's heavy, and it's got all these cool tools on it. It's got, you know, things that pop out here. I'll show you some of the cool things that come on these vests, and if I have them, where are they at? Oh, there it is. You got these things like this that pop out, and, you know, so you can hit, say, no, I'm not going to hit any of you. But it's a different role that I play, and this is what I wear. It's my wardrobe. And then on Saturday afternoon, I wake up after being up all night, and I go out and I grab my lock boxes for my real estate, and I go out and I put my signs in somebody's yards. I got a little key card, opens doors, and I dress kind of like this, at least somewhat like this. And then I get done on Sunday. I come here on Sunday morning, and Sunday night, I do become a youth pastor. And youth pastor, our things are basketballs and things and tools to draw in young people, dodgeballs, which this would be kind of fun. I could really enjoy this part. I get 6 shots. Who am I going to hit? No. And I put on sweatpants, and so my wardrobe changes to match the job at hand. And my wardrobe changes because kind of my identity changes at each one of these segments. And you have the same thing. You can maybe have a different clothes you wear at work, or when you go to do certain sports, you wear a different wardrobe. And so Paul is setting us up to enter into this next section of the passage because he's ready to tell us, you know what? You have a new life. Your old one was hidden. Your new one, this new clothing that you're putting on, and that is so that I've given you, become as a Christ follower, is different than the wardrobe than your identity from the past. Now, professionally, we can change wardrobes quite a bit, and we do this just to make it through a day. But unfortunately, the one wardrobe that I wear consistently under each one of these garments is my identity in Christ. It's a new self. It's a new wardrobe. And so as Paul's explaining here, he's explaining, when you came to Christ, your wardrobe changed. And it wasn't just a simple changing that you can rotate on and off like I do my little outfits that I wear during a weekend. This one is a permanent change that takes place. Now, this is very important for us to hear because what many of us try to do is we try to keep, let's be honest. If I wore a bulletproof vest and a gun belt to youth group, now, they would probably listen a lot better. Matter of fact, my wife, who teaches fifth grade, she thinks a taser should be standard issue to all teachers. You know, she thinks that should be. But this tier is inconsistent with this. Even if I show up in a police gear to show houses, they're going to, what are you doing? But worse even yet, what if I bring my youth stuff and I show up in sweatpants with a dodgeball? Want me to show you a $200,000 house? You want me to help you through your contracts? They're like, no, we don't. We want you to wash our car or something, you know? That's all. So it's inconsistent to have an identity and not have a matching wardrobe with that new identity. And so what we're about to enter into is Paul laying out, this is your old identity that is no longer consistent with the character of Christ and the character that God is of a Christian. Okay? So you've got to get this concept. So we have to learn how to put off and take off and, you know, how do I make this all match up? And so here, listen to this passage. It goes, when Christ, who is your life, appears, then you will also appear with him. Now, the reason is this. We don't know when that appear part's going to happen. When is Jesus going to reappear? And I'm thinking, which wardrobe in life are you going to be wearing when Jesus reappears? Are you still going to be wearing your old self? And we're going to make a list of those soon, and they're going to get kind of touchy. They're going to get kind of personal. Or is, when you show up, are you going to be dressed more like him? Dressed to join in. So let's read on. Verse 5. Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to earthly nature. This is your old self. Sexual immorality. Let's just stop there. Before we can get to that, put to death. Have you thought about that? Let me tell you, I was in Mexico this one year, and we were staying at this very nice place. We were on a mission trip. I had about 60 kids with me. We're in Mexico. It's awesome. And we had this house. It actually had a pool. We thought we were in bonus land. Like, this is the best place ever. I've ever stayed on a mission trip. Usually it's like a garage or a church floor. But we still had to sleep on the floors, but this big house had a pool. We were really pumped. Go to bed at night. We wake up the next morning, and we all look around our beds, and there's hundreds of dead cockroaches. Hey, they were dead. You know, they were dead. So we're like, okay. And we're like, we're kind of glad they're dead, but there's a lot of cockroaches. Oh, we just had the house exterminated just before you guys got here. And I'm like, that's great. How long does this stuff take to kill them once they go through it? Oh, about 15 minutes. How far can a cockroach crawl in 15 minutes? Quite a far. You know, that's a long time. I mean, they're little, but they're fast little guys. And so we're in this place, and every morning we would wake up, and there'd be dead cockroaches around our beds, sometimes on our beds. And so we were kind of freaking out. But this is kind of when we talk about putting to death. Now, that sounds gross enough. But when Jesus says here, when Paul says here, it says, put to death your old ways, he says the things of the darkness need to die. The things of the darkness need to be dead. And we've all, when you flip on a light, the little things scurry. I'd rather see them dead than scurrying still. I want them to be dead. But here's what this passage is saying. If we don't learn how, we have to learn how to put things to death. Some of us, not only are they dead and we put them to death at some point in time, but we scoop up their little bodies and we carry them in our pockets. Ew, that's gross. Why would you do that? But that's kind of what Jesus is going to share with you. And Paul's sharing is this. He goes, many of us, we put to death these old ways, but we continue to carry them around with us throughout the day. So just got to get this idea. What does it mean to put something to death? It means it is done. It is final. And it's supposed to be discarded and left behind to rot somewhere else. But a lot of us, we put them in our pockets. And if I walked up to you and I said, how's your new faith? How's your new life doing? Oh, it's doing really good. Just don't check my back pocket. You don't want to look there. That's where I keep the dead cockroaches in my life. So let's look at some of these things that are supposed to be dead in our life. Just kind of this death thing. We have to get, I'll get you in a second here. Okay, here's this. Sexual morality. Isn't it weird that's the first one mentioned? But I would say that most of us, if we were honest, it's probably the first one that's caused us problems at some point in life. It's caused us big damage. And I know some of you are a non-believer, this is right where you start thinking, bam, now you're already getting into your judgmental ways about sex, and you know, all this kind of, your sex is bad, you're going to tell me how bad sex is. I'm going to, no, I'm going to tell you sex is great. It's God created, God intended for the right spot. Kind of think of this fire. Fire, you can have a barbecue, make some great ribs, right? Fire's good, right? There. Fire's good when you're at a campfire, when it's inside the little fire circle, and you're kicking back, and you're having a great time, and everybody's enjoying talk and conversation. You like fire when it's in your furnace, because it keeps your house warm and cozy. But if you're smoking a cigarette, putting the nozzle into the gas tank of your car, what do we say that is? Stupid, right? Now, if that happens to be somebody else's car, that's called adultery. Let that sink in for a second. You get it? Some of you guys got to think that through. What did he say? Okay, so fire is explosive, and then when you mix it into relationships, you mix it into outside of where God intended it to be, it's explosive. Same thing with sexual sins. Within the confinements in your marriage, how God intended, it's a wonderful, great thing and joy. But outside of that context, and it completely, completely will explode and blow up in your face. But we have struggles beyond struggles with this kind of stuff, sexual morality. Some of you have been cheated on at some point in time. Some of you have been the cheaters. And you know and understand the impact, the depth of the hurt that was caused. Some of us, let's even just get out of outside of marriage. Let's think of when we were younger and we were doing things that we shouldn't be doing. And we tried walking in and say, oh, it has no impact. But it does. I often use an illustration when I talk to youth about sexual stuff is this. I usually pull up my arm, and I got hairy arms because it's growing onto my back, you know. And so I'll take the duct tape, I'll take everything of duct tape, and I'll put it on my arm, and I'm like, I'll mash it down really good, and I'll rip it off. And it's like, ow, and you know, they can see all the hair left on there, you know, it's all that hurts. And then I'll put the tape back on that same spot and I'll pull again. Doesn't hurt as bad the second time, does it? Because the tape was supposed to keep to stay there. And so things when sex is done in the right situation inside of the marriage, a godly marriage, it was intended to stick together forever and never be removed. But when those of us who made mistakes when we were younger, we kept pulling, we kept having relations with other people, and the stickiness, the glue of it all has kind of faded. And you brought that into your marriages. And I say that maybe a lot of times for our young people. It just seems like a quick thing. Oh, it's just about fun. But the sexual morality thing does damage long term. It takes away the stickiness of God intended for that to happen inside the right context. Let's move on. That gets the next one. We get into impurity. Now, impurities, I'm just going to show you a video just to teach you about impurity. Just can we do the video? Just show. That's the best way I can describe impurity, right? It looks so innocent. It seems so simple. It's just a little kiss. It's just a little kiss. I'm, you know, it's no big deal to me. It's not a big deal. But that little kiss is exposing you to things that you don't want to be exposed to, isn't it? And we find this in every area of our life. And we find this in areas that we just said the videos we watch, the TV shows we watch, the music we listen to, the websites we visit. These just a little bit. I'm only looking at the swimsuit issue. It's not the nudie swimsuit issue. You know, the nude issue, it's not a big deal. But it creates this little speck of impurity that if we were honest and we looked at it from like the video that we see here, yuck, gross. And if we could see it through God's perspective, how that when he sees us just dabbling with these little impurities and we see it from this perspective, we go, oh, that's what it's like? It's like kissing a fecal matter mirror. That's gross. And we laugh about it. But some of us, we've been exposing ourselves to these impurities for so long that we've missed the real impact of what they're doing to us. So that's the best thing for impurity. Okay, look at these other things we're supposed to separate ourselves from. Passion. Now, when we see passion, we think, lust is what's less than this one. Lust and passion. Lust is understandable. It's the visual gates. It's me standing on that stupid steep stairs. You know, everywhere I look, there's something to lust after. There's people in bathing suits and things like that. Women, I wish you could just walk through the mall with a guy's perspective. You would be terrified. The things that you just walking through a mall. Between the posters, the mannequins, the whatever there might be, the people walking around, it's hard to not find yourself being eye gate guys being led astray. I don't know what it does for what girls think about, but this is a guy thing. I'm giving you a guy perspective. You might maybe consider how you dress. because it does impact us. It's that lustful thing. Now, it's also another passage, another translation, they use the word passion for this one. And passions aren't bad in their initial, it's not a big deal to have passion, but often, what are you passionate about? Usually we're passionate about things that are quick, pleasurable items. So he's saying you got to hold those passions, those lusts in check. Evil desires is it's kind of like a magnified, overbearing sense of wanting to do something that you know you shouldn't. You know, it's kind of like, what can I do to do something bad next? You know, kind of like the evil little guy looking around going like, what can I do evil next? And sometimes we have those desires that are kind of welling up inside of us, and we got to keep those in check. They are inconsistent with God's character, and so thus they're inconsistent with our new identity in Christ. If you find yourself struggling with those things, we got to find a way to put them to death. In your small groups questions this week, we're going to talk about some of that stuff. Now, nobody avoids small. If you don't show up to small group, we're going to know you're avoiding stuff, okay? So you all got to show up for your small groups this week. So those things. The last one's greed. This is going to sound weird. We're made to worship things. We're made to worship. Unfortunately, when our worship becomes away from God, it becomes idolatry. But we're made to worship. You were called to worship. When we walk in here, you were called to we do worship through music. We do worship in how we live our lives. We worship God in our thought life. We were meant to worship, and so we are called to do that. But when it becomes something other than God, it's idolatry. So the question is, what are some things that you find yourself becoming idle over? Because idolatry leads to laziness. Laziness means just cruising in the current. And God's called us something different. Now we're going to touch on something that's really kind of funny. The passage goes on, because of these, the wrath of God is coming. How can a loving God have wrath? Isn't that inconsistent with what we've learned about God? He's loving and forgiving. What's wrath got to do with this? A lot of your non-believing friends, when they see God, they see wrath. And like, your God's just full of wrath. Look at what he's done. He has all these rules and these things. He just judges people all day long. It's wrath. I don't want anything to do with that. So how do we work with this passage through this scripture is this. Wrath of God is constructive. There's destructive wrath, and there's constructive wrath. I'll give you an example of deconstructive wrath. I'm driving down the road. You cut me off. I drive up alongside of you. I slam my car into yours, shove you off a cliff over, and you burn and die. Deconstructive wrath. Everybody agree? Completely agree. Justifiable even to some. Yes. I got a commendation for killing. No. So, but what about this? My daughter goes away to college someday, and some guy takes advantage of her and assaults her. I'm going to have wrath. It's going to be angry. Matter of fact, to not feel anger in that situation would be almost anti-parent, anti-loving. I'm going to have a built-up just wrath within me. Somebody takes my son, starts hooking him up with drugs, there's going to be wrath within me because you're hurting the one that I love. Well, then how does this happen? Well, what happens is this. Unfortunately, some people, okay, let's say my daughter, this person who assaults her, and I know assaulted her and hurt her, she ends up dating him long term, getting married to the guy. My anger and wrath towards him and what happened, she's now connected to it. And so sometimes she's going to be caught up and she's going to feel it. The wrath was never intended for God's children. The wrath is against the sin that is happening in the lives of our children and happening in the lives of in the world that we live in. That's where the wrath is against, because he sees how it's hurting his children. But unfortunately, sometimes we get caught in the middle of it. And we feel like God's wrath is against us. And it's not against us. It's when he's wanting to get through you to get you to break away from the thing that holds you down. He is wrath. But it's constructive wrath. His desire is not to beat you down. His desire in his wrath is to destroy the thing that's tearing you down. To destroy the thing that's killing his kids. You're his kids. He wants to destroy the things that are within our world and within you that are keeping you from achieving and matching the identity that he has created for you. That's his wrath. He goes on a little bit further and says this. Now, if you thought you were going to kind of escape the first one, here's the next list. Okay. Let me see here. Verse 7 says this. You used to walk in these ways in the life you once lived. Now, what's happening here is Jesus is basically saying, if you're still playing with these old things, here, let me give you an illustration. So I have a box of things that I've had since I was little. I have it's called Roger's Memories Box. And it has a lot of things in it that from my past, things, toys I used to play with, things I made when I was little. It has a football helmet that I wore my senior year of high school that I stole. It has all this kind of stuff in it. Now, it has my letter sweater and stuff like that, you know? Now, think back to when you were in high school, and maybe some of you when you went to college. Did you really wear your letter sweater to college? Probably not. Sometimes, first, you'd see somebody walk around in their letter jacket in college, but usually it was kind of like, man, that was high school. You're done with that. You've matured past that. Or maybe you had toys that you thought were the coolest thing ever back in the day, but now you realize it's just a toy. Some of you, you might have video game systems that you used to love and used to monopolize your life and time. But now, it's not really a big deal. We all have these things in our past that we've grown out of. And as we read these lists of things, we're supposed to see these things. We're growing out of these ways. We're growing out of these ideas. We're growing out of this. We're maturing. The day I was born, I had no control of. I had no control of the day I was born. Whatever mom and dad did to get me here, I don't want to know anything about, okay? But they did what they did. I'm here. I'm born. Had nothing to do with it. But I do have responsibility in my maturity and my growth from this point forward. And so this pastor is saying, these are your old ways. This is how you used to live. It's now time to take some responsibility in your growth. It's time to take responsibility in how you progress and how you mature. So here we go. Let's list some more things here. Verse 8. But now you must also rid yourselves of all such things as these: anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. See, the first list we were all pretty much good with. I haven't had sexual morality. I haven't done any of that. I haven't done any of that. This list, boom, gets us all right between the eyes at some point, doesn't it? We're all guilty of some of these. We've all made mistakes in these. Some of us are still carrying, especially in this realm, the dead cockroaches of their past needs, their past wants, their past anger, their past attitudes towards certain people. They're still carrying that around with them in their pockets. And what God's saying is, I want you to rid yourself of those things. No longer domesticate them into your life. Has anybody seen this show, When Animals Attack? You seen this one? It's basically people, and it's silly people. They get like pet lions, and they raise them from cubs, and they're just thinking, oh, he's the cutest little cub. He's a lion. I got him in my backyard. He hangs out in my front room. He's a lion. And then one day he eats them. The lion eats the people. Sometimes we try to domesticate sin. And so we look at this second list. We go, well, this is part of living life, Roger. It's okay if I'm angry. It's okay if I say a few bad jokes. It's okay if my Facebook page has F this, F that all over it. It's okay. It's not a big deal. It is a big deal. It's okay that all this part's inconsistent. These are just little things. People understand. You're domesticating a lion. It's going to come back and get you. You're not its master. You're its meal. And so we can't sit there and domesticate. So when we look at this list of these little things, we got to take this serious. It goes on and says this, verse 9. Do not lie to each other. Since you have taken off your old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge in the image of its creator. Don't lie. One of the things I think is fine tragic and just faith, and probably why sometimes I scare Jim when I talk, is I try to be very authentic and transparent about my own struggles. And it scares Jim to death because he doesn't know what I'm going to say. This might be my last time ever speaking in front of you. Because I think we waste so much time as Christians lying to one another, faking it, and putting on facades. You're going to be in small groups. Some of you are in small groups this week, and you have been going for 6 weeks, and you haven't shared anything beyond the superficial. It's got to change. You're lying. And we just see, we're not supposed to lie anymore. We're in this together. We got to change. There should be change happening. Do not lie to each other. It's being renewed daily. Verse 11. Here, there is no Gentile or Jew, circumcised, uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, I'll say, slave or free, but Christ is all and is in all. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. And let's just let those words sit in for a while. Now, he goes through the one list just to say our position. Our position is basically Christ is our Savior. We are his children. Because of that, this is what, because we are his chosen people, here are the indicators of growth in our life. Our salvation is secured. I had nothing to do with my birth, but I have some responsibilities in my growth. It isn't for me to earn God's love. It isn't for me to earn God's salvation again. It is purely that if this is my new identity, I want to wear the wardrobe that matches Christ's identity in my life. To do so any otherwise is foolish. I want to be consistent. I want to understand his character. I think it's also interesting to say that we look at this list and we go, I have to do all this at one time? And we're all going to be stronger at certain things. My brother is way more patient than I am. My wife is way more compassionate than I am. I'm growing in all. I need to be growing. And these should be the things I'm pursuing, I'm relentlessly pursuing in my life, is that these become more evident in my life. These are indicators of growth. Let's move on. Verse 13. Bear with each other. And forgive one another. If any of you has a grievance against someone, forgive as the Lord forgave you, and over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Hurting someone is a given. It will happen. We as Christians are different because we forgive when it happens. That's what makes us different. You will tick off somebody in your small group. You will hurt somebody's feelings. They will hurt you. Your relationship, your marriage, somebody's going to say something one day, it's going to make you mad. What makes us different is the forgiveness, because we understand what Christ did for us. We understand that he came to chose to love us before we loved him. That's supposed to be our new character. That's what we're supposed to understand. Move on. Let the peace of Christ in your hearts rule in your hearts, since as a member of one body, you were called to peace, and be thankful. That last word is probably the thing I find the most interesting, and be thankful. Because of all this, be thankful. But when we miss this holy intro part and we misunderstand what Christ did, the first two chapters of Colossians, and we miss the application of it, we sometimes don't find ourselves very thankful for anything. God hasn't given me this. God didn't give me that. God didn't do this for me. God's saying, I gave you your life. I gave you forgiveness. I give you my son. What else do you want? That's supposed to be we're supposed to be like, oh, you're right. I understand now. Let's be grateful for things. I want to put this challenge out. As a matter of fact, I don't know if this is the next slide or not, where it says there is a difference between supernaturally changed. Here's what this gets down to. Some of us have experienced this new life, but a lot of us have been faking it for a long time. Look at this board, look at this sentence. There's a difference between superly naturally changed heart and a morally restrained heart. Many of us are bored and feel numb to our faith because we've been living a morally restrained life. If I don't do this, I'll look good. If I don't do this means God must love me more. If I do this, God's gonna, and it's just morally restraining the things that you really are thinking about in your head. versus what God calls us to is this whole new identity, this whole new self, this whole new creation. There's a difference. That's a supernaturally changed heart. If you've become satisfied with a morally restrained heart, you're going to get tired out. You can only be good so long. You can only keep up your good habits for so long. Eventually, you become numb, and you'll just be drifting around the lazy river forever. I'm calling this all out today. Are you ready for a supernaturally changed heart today? Do you want something different? Do you want to feel God's presence again? Not all emotional stuff, but do you want to have peace? That verse, the passage before said, peace inside to face the storms, the clarity to see things through God's eyes. I'm going to ask you a few questions. Can you drop down to the end? Let's just do the questions. Throwing them off in the back. There's three questions at the end. Can you drop down to those? I just threw them on the spot. Here we go. Are there any areas of my life right now that aren't reflecting the lordship of Jesus? Somebody hit this home. Is there anything going on in your life right now that if you were honest, it's inconsistent, you're putting on some other garb, you're putting on some other wardrobe, it's inconsistent with what God has called you to be? The identity that Christ has given you, the character. We're supposed to be revealing God's glory to the world, and revealing glory means this, revealing God's character and likeness to the world. We're supposed to glorify God. We're supposed to reveal him to the world. That's our calling. That's your calling as a Christian, to reveal God to other people, his character and his likeness. Is there anything that's not doing that right now? How about the next one? Have I declared war on my sin, or have I domesticated it? Am I really ready to put it to death? Sweep it up and throw it away, or am I sweeping it up and putting it in my pocket like those roaches? Have you declared war on your sin? Next one. When I stumble and fall, where do I run? We're all going to stumble and fall. Probably the final indicator of growth in our life is that when it happens, when we fall, when we stumble, those who understand who Christ is and what he did on a cross for you, for us, run back to him. The immature run and hide. The immature scurry back into the darkness. The immature are fine drifting and floating in the currents. But if you've been called, if God has made you a new person, he wants you to know that when you stumble, run back. Run back to me. When your kids make a mistake, what do you want them to say? You want them to walk in the room and say, I blew it. I made a mistake. Versus you finding out from somebody else's parent, versus you finding out 3 years later that they did something. You want them that after it happens, that they love you, that there's enough of a relationship there that they come to you and say, I know I messed up. So those three questions are big. There's a life application of this passage. As we close in prayer, are there any of those things that we need to kind of contemplate? You're going to be rehashing some of this during your small groups, and I hope that you go beyond the superficial this week. If it's not during your small group, I hope you call up somebody else that you trust as a faithful friend and talk to them. No longer be satisfied with the lazy river. It's a war against your sin. Let me close in prayer.